गुड मॉर्निंग कंटिन्यूशन ऑफ डिसऑर्डर ऑफ एड्रेनल ग्लैंड इन दैट हाइपो फंक्शन ऑफ एड्रेनल ग्लैंड हाइपो फंक्शन ऑफ एड्रेनल ग्लैंड इंक्लूड्स एड्रेनोकॉर्टिकल डिफिशियंसी अदरवाइज कॉल्ड एड्रेनल इनसफिशियंसी हाइपोऑल्ड्रेनर्जम एंड कंजेंटल एड्रेनल हाइपरप्लेजिया एड्रेनोकॉर्टिकल डिफिशियंसी और एड्रेनल इनसफिशियंसी इन विच is a decreased secretion of glucocorticoids, mineralocorticoids and androgen is seen. Hypoaldosteronism is a condition, there is a isolated aldosterone deficiency with normal cortisol production associated with hyporeninism. Congenital adrenal hyperplasia is a group of rare inherited autosomal recessive disorder characterized by one of the deficiency of enzyme in the synthesis of glucocorticoids or mineralocorticoids or both. So coming to the adrenocortical deficiency, otherwise called adrenal insufficiency. Adrenal insufficiency will be taught under these headings: definition of adrenal insufficiency, types, etiology, epidemiology, clinical feature, complication, investigation, and treatment of adrenal insufficiency. So by definition, adrenal insufficiency is a condition where there is a decreased secretion of all the three hormones, that is glucocorticoids, mineralocorticoids and androgen from the adrenal gland. So what are the types of adrenal insufficiency? So depending upon the onset of adrenal insufficiency and depending upon the site of involved. So depending upon the onset of adrenal insufficiency, acute adrenal insufficiency and chronic adrenal insufficiency. Acute means sudden onset of adrenal insufficiency, whereas chronic means incidence onset over days to months. Depending upon the site of involved, is primary adrenal insufficiency, secondary adrenal insufficiency or tertiary adrenal insufficiency. So primary adrenal insufficiency also called Addison's disease. So adrenal insufficiency, in primary adrenal insufficiency, pathology lies in the adrenal gland itself. There is a failure of adrenal glands to secrete the hormones, either glucocorticoid, mineralocorticoid or androgens. In secondary adrenal insufficiency, there is a failure of hypothalamo-pituitary adrenal axis or pituitary gland. This hypothalamo-pituitary adrenal axis failure due to chronic exogenous glucocorticoid administration. So pituitary failure may be due to pituitary gland necrosis or following surgical removal of the gland. So tertiary adrenal insufficiency is, here is pathology lies in the hypothalamus, that is hypothalamic dysfunction you can see in. So come to the primary adrenal insufficiency, otherwise called Addison disease. This primary adrenal insufficiency is a condition where the decreased secretion of all the three types of hormone, that is glucocorticoid, mineralocorticoid and androgens. So before manifestation clinically, almost 90% of the gland is destroyed in primary adrenal insufficiency. Though the adrenal gland is high functional reserve, means till the last stage also is functioning. This Addison disease is first described by English physician called Thomas Addison almost 150 years back only. That's why this primary adrenal insufficiency also called Addison's disease. So come to the etiology or causes of primary adrenal insufficiency. There's the five major causes. First one is idiopathic atrophy, second one is surgical removal, third one is thrombosis or hemorrhage, fourth one infiltrative disease, fifth is infections. Idiopathic atrophy, there is a suppression and atrophy of the adrenal gland either due to autoimmune etiology
or a part of inattent disorder like adrenal leukodystrophy. So autoimmune disorder commonly seen almost 80% of the individual, especially in females. But if you take Indians, only 50% will have autoimmune atrophy you can see in. Adrenal leukodystrophy is a X-linked inherited disorder of very long chain fatty acid metabolism. In this condition, there is a progressive neurological symptom due to the demyelination. So males are most commonly affected with adrenal leukodystrophy. Following surgery of adrenal gland, that is bilateral adrenalectomy, also result in adrenal insufficiency. Following thrombosis hemorrhage to the adrenal gland due to sepsis or DIC or antiphospholipid syndrome, or bilateral hemorrhage to the adrenal gland following meningococcal septicemia, that is called Waters-Fredrickson syndrome, following trauma also result in adrenal insufficiency. Infiltrative diseases like metastasis to bilateral adrenal gland, amyloidosis and hemosiderosis causes adrenal insufficiency. So infections, that is tuberculosis, most common infectious cause in worldwide in developing country like India, is almost 50% of the patient of adrenalitis will have a tuberculosis. This tuberculosis usually spread to the adrenal gland through the hematogenous spread from the primary, either from the lung or anywhere. If you take the adrenal gland, almost 50% of the patient will have a adrenal gland is enlarged, caseation and fibrosis with calcification can seen in a adrenal insufficiency. Fungal infection like histoplasmosis, cryptococcosis also causes adrenal insufficiency. HIV infection is a most common infectious cause in United States. Here is almost 50% will have a destruction. Once you diagnose a HIV associated primary adrenal insufficiency, only 5% will have a clinical symptoms of adrenal insufficiency. CME infection, ketoconazole use, macrophage related cytokine or additional risk factor that increases the adrenalitis in a patient with Addison disease. Autoimmune adrenalitis is a condition. Almost 30-40% of patient will have presented with isolated autoimmune adrenalitis. Rest 60-70% is a part of autoimmune polyglandular syndrome. It has two types, APS1 and APS2. APS1 is usually associated with AIRE gene, is a autosomal recessive disorder. Associated disorders are hypoparathyroidism, chronic mucocutaneous candidiasis and rarely lymphoma. APS2 is a polygenic involvement, that is associated with HLA-DR3, CTLA-4 gene. This associated with diseases hypothyroidism, hyperthyroidism, premature ovarian failure, vitiligo, type 1 diabetes mellitus and pernicious anemia. So you can demonstrate autoantibodies to the 21-hydroxyl in autoimmune adrenalitis. So if you take the incidence of other endocrine and autoimmune diseases in a patient with autoimmune adrenalitis, so if you take the thyroid disorders with autoimmune adrenalitis, 8% will have hypothyroidism, about 7% will have non-toxic goiter and thyrotoxicosis. If you take the gonadal failure, 20% will have ovarian failure, 2% will have testicular failure. 11% of insulin dependent diabetes mellitus will have associated autoimmune adrenalitis. 10% hypoparathyroidism, 5% pernicious anemia. So more than 50% of autoimmune adrenalitis not associated with any diseases.
come to the epidemiology of primary adrenal insufficiency, otherwise called Addison disease. Addison disease is a rare endocrine disorder, affect 1 in every 1 lakh of individual, occurs in all the age groups, equally affect in both men as well as women. So come to the secondary adrenal insufficiency. Etiology or causes of secondary adrenal insufficiency are hypothalamo-pituitary adrenal axis failure. Here there is a deficiency of glucocorticoids and androgens, but mineralocorticoids are unaffected. So most common cause of HPA axis failure is chronic exogenous glucocorticoid administration. Once you administer the glucocorticoid, there is a suppression of diurnal CRH AV release. This glucocorticoid administration is both time and dose related, and this HPA axis will be reversible, but it takes up to a year to reverse the condition. So idiopathic suppression or idiopathic glucocorticoid administration, that is exogenous glucocorticoid administration, will have a list to the suppression and atrophy of adrenal gland. So this is depending upon the dosing and timing pattern of glucocorticoid administration. If a dose more than 30 mg of hydrocortisone per day orally, equivalent dose is approximately 7.5 mg of prednisolone, 0.75 mg of dexamethasone per day for more than 3 weeks will result in HPA axis failure or suppression of HPA. Timing also important, that is higher dose in the evening will have a greater suppression of HPA. Also inadequate replacement in a patient on glucocorticoid replacement during the period of stress also will result in HPA axis failure or HPA axis suppression. Myth buster. So there is a false belief that even short course and steroid dose 5 mg or less than mg will result in the suppression of HPA axis. But this is not true. Short course, that is 2 to 3 weeks, unlikely to suppress the HPA axis. Daily dose of prednisolone 5 mg or less than that are unlikely to cause a secondary adrenal insufficiency. Other less common causes of secondary adrenal insufficiency are postpartum necrosis, that is Sheehan syndrome, pituitary adenoma hemorrhages, pituitary destruction from the head injury. So usually patients have present a focal neurological deficits, visual defects along with diabetes insipidus, or they present a panhypopituitarism. So come to the clinical features. So clinical features of adrenal insufficiency, depending upon which hormone has deficiency, whether it is glucocorticoid, mineralocorticoid or androgens. If a deficiency of glucocorticoid hormone will result in, or will patient present a 99% weakness, 97% weight loss, about 90% of patient will have anorexia, nausea, vomiting, and there is a malaise, fatigue, myalgia, joint pain and fever. Gastrointestinal symptoms like diarrhea or constipation, about 20%. On examination, there is a postural hypotension seen in 80% of the patient. There is hypoglycemia and an investigation. If a deficiency of mineralocorticoids will result in hypotension, hyponatremia in 80% of the patient, hyperkalemia about 40% of the patient. So some patients present a hyperpigmentation, almost 98% of the patient, due to the excess ACTH secretion. This hyperpigmentation seen in sun exposed area, pressure area like elbow, knee, palmar crease,
nipples, nail, knuckles, gums, buccal mucosa, tongue, conjunctiva and or recent scar. So this is the picture showing a hyperpigmentation over the sun exposed area, especially in the foot over the knuckle area. So this is the picture showing a hyperpigmentation in the gums and also in the buccal mucosa. So this is a picture of hand showing a hyperpigmentation over the palm or crease. So this is a picture showing a knuckle pigmentation over the hands, and also there is a hyperpigmentation in the buccal mucosa. If a deficiency of androgen or decreased secretion of androgen will result in decreased body hairs, that is axillary and pubic hair, and loss of libido seen especially in females. So diagnostic criteria of Addison disease is a triad of weakness or emaciation, pigmentation and hypotension. If three feature is there, you can straight away say patient has got Addison disease. So what are the difference between the primary and secondary adrenal insufficiency? Primary means Addison disease, secondary means there is a iatrogenic glucocorticoid administration. In primary adrenal insufficiency, there is a hyperpigmentation is seen, whereas secondary there is no hyperpigmentation because ACTH levels are very low. So multiple hormone deficiency are usually seen in secondary adrenal insufficiency, whereas primary adrenal insufficiency you are not seeing any multiple hormone deficiency. Dehydration, hyperkalemia, hyponatremia because of mineralocorticoid deficiency usually seen in primary adrenal insufficiency, whereas secondary usually absent because mineralocorticoids are unaffected. So aldosterone secretion is decreased in case of primary adrenal insufficiency, whereas secondary adrenal insufficiency almost normal or near normal. So come to the investigation of adrenal insufficiency. Routine investigation, that is complete blood count. So important HP, especially if you are suspecting a pernicious anemia, hemoglobin will be low. Blood glucose level, that is random blood glucose, which is low or lower limit, especially severe seen in Addison crisis or acute adrenal insufficiency. So electrolytes, that is there is a decreased sodium level, that is hyponatremia, and increased potassium level, that is hyperkalemia seen. So hyponatremia is more important than the hyperkalemia. Test to find out the causes. So chest x-ray is important to know the patient has tuberculosis or not. Plain x-ray of abdomen to see the calcification as a result of tuberculosis. Autoantibodies estimation, that is against 21 hydroxyase, usually not available in India. To know the pathology of adrenal gland, to do ultrasonography and CT scan. To know the pathology of pituitary gland, MRI of pituitary gland, HIV test, and thyroid profile, that is T3, T4, THS, if autoimmune etiology suspected. So other tests includes plasma calcium level is increased, plasma renin activity is increased, plasma aldosterone level is low in case of primary adrenal insufficiency. So initially if you are suspecting any adrenal insufficiency, do the random plasma cortisol level. So usually this random plasma cortisol level are low, maybe within normal limit. So exclude the diagnosis if value is more than 16.5 microgram per deciliter. To confirm the diagnosis, you have to do short ACTH stimulation test or short synaptin test or lung ACTH stimulation test. How to do this short ACT stimulation test? Otherwise called rapid ACT stimulation test. It's a screening test to diagnose adrenal insufficiency. Here we are using a synthetic ACTH, that is synactin or cosyntropin. So 250 microgram of cosyntropin is injected either IM or IV and measure the plasma cortisol response after the 30 to 60 minutes. If cortisol level more than 500 nanomoles per liter or more than 18 microgram per deciliter, think there is a normal response. If the value is less than 18 microgram per deciliter, you suspect there is an adrenal insufficiency. So this test used to assess the adrenal reserve capacity for steroid production, and this test can be done at any time of the day. Long ACTH stimulation test be performed. 1 milligram of cosyntropin given intramuscularly and blood samples collected at 1 hour, 4 hour, 8 hour, 24 hours later. So normal plasma cortisol levels are reached almost 100 nanomoles per liter or 36 microgram per deciliter by 4 hour normally. In a patient with primary adrenal insufficiency or Addison disease, this cortisol levels are reduced in all the stages, whereas in secondary adrenal insufficiency, delayed but normal response you can see. So how to differentiate between primary and secondary adrenal insufficiency? You have diagnosed that there is a adrenal insufficiency is present. To know whether it's primary adrenal insufficiency or secondary adrenal insufficiency, you have to measure the plasma ACTH level, aldosterone level and plasma renin level. If plasma ACTH level is elevated more than 100 picogram per ml, think there is a primary adrenal insufficiency. In secondary adrenal insufficiency, plasma ACTH level is low or normal. So aldosterone level is decreased in case of primary adrenal insufficiency, whereas normal in case of secondary adrenal insufficiency. Plasma renin values will be increased in primary adrenal insufficiency, whereas secondary is normal. So in primary adrenal insufficiency, plasma ACTH level is increase with decrease aldosterone level, it increase renin level, whereas secondary adrenal insufficiency ACTH level lower normal with normal aldosterone and renin levels. So this is a flow chart how to approach a case of adrenal insufficiency. A patient has a signs and symptoms suggestive of adrenal insufficiency, do the screening test, that is short ACTH stimulation test after 250 microgram injection of cosyntropin IM or IV. If plasma cortisol level is more than 18 microgram per deciliter after 30 to 60 minutes, think of there is a possible adrenal insufficiency. To know the primary and secondary adrenal insufficiency, you have to measure the plasma ACTH level, plasma aldosterone level and renin level. If plasma ACTH level is high and low aldosterone level or subnormal aldosterone increment, you think there is a primary adrenal insufficiency. Low or normal ACTH level with normal aldosterone level, normal renin level, we think there is a secondary adrenal insufficiency. So coming to the treatment of adrenal insufficiency, treatment of primary adrenal insufficiency is replacement therapy, that is whatever the loss of hormone you have to replace. So replacement may include both glucocorticoids as well as mineralocorticoids hormones. So glucocorticoid supplementation is, so hydrocortisone, that is cortisol, is the mainstay of treatment with a dose of 15 to 25 milligram per day in 2 to 3 divided doses along with meal with milk or antacid to prevent the increased gastric acidity or direct toxic effect on gastric mucosa. So alternatively, you can use prednisolone 2.5 to 5 milligram per day, 2 divided dose. This dosing and timing pattern is very important. So majority of the dose, that is 2/3 of the dose, should be given in the morning. 1/3 of the dose is given in the late afternoon. So this stimulates the normal diurnal rhythm. So mineralocorticoid supplementation includes fludrocortisone with a dose of 0.1 to 0.15 mg per day orally, that is 100 to 150 microgram per day orally, along with ample of intake of sodium. This adequacy of mineralocorticoid therapy can assess by plasma sodium level and postural DOP, that is supine and erect blood pressure estimation, and plasma renin activity levels estimation. Those who have androgen deficiency, especially in case of female patients, so daily replacement of 25 to 50 milligram of dihydroepiandrosterone orally will improve the quality of life as well as increase the bone mineral density. So other treatment for cause, if a tuberculosis is there, you start anti-tubercular drugs. General advice to the patient is good nutrition, regular meal, high carbohydrate and sufficient salt. When patient is not taking orally, then you can give IV preparation, that is injection hydrocortisone can be given. So treatment of secondary adrenal insufficiency is, again is here also glucocorticoid therapy and mineralocorticoid therapy. So glucocorticoid therapy is not much differ with compared with primary adrenal insufficiency. It is almost same treatment will use here secondary adrenal insufficiency also. But mineralocorticoid therapy is not necessarily, because aldosterone secretion is preserved. So most of the patients of secondary adrenal insufficiencies record, but it will take time, that is from days to months. Special therapeutic problems. Those who are already diagnosed and treatment for adrenal insufficiency will develop any illness or undergoing surgery or stress. So you have to take a special precaution while treating the patient. So if a patient develop a intercurrent illness like fever during the therapy of adrenal insufficiency, you have to increase the dose of hydrocortisone to double. So earlier patient taking 10 milligram, you have to increase the dose to the 20 milligram in those of patient with fever. Increase the dose of fludrocortisone by 0.05 to 0.1 milligram and add a salt in a situation with strenuous exercise, with sweating, extreme hot weather, gastrointestinal upset like diarrhea. In this situation, you have to increase the dose of fludrocortisone by 0.05 to 1 milligram. So minor procedure, no extra supplementation. Those who moderate procedures like endoscopy or angiography, single dose of 100 milligram of hydrocortisone given prior to the procedure. Those who have moderate illness or minor surgery in the hospital, give 50 milligram of hydrocortisone BD orally or IV and taper the dose to maintain dose once the patient has recovered. In case of severe illness, severe stress, trauma or major surgery, so give hydrocortisone 100
milligram just before the induction and continue every 6th hourly for first 24 hours, then taper to the half a dose to the maintenance. So these are the equivalent dose of glucocorticoids. So 20 milligram of hydrocortisone equivalent to 25 milligram of cortisone acetate, 5 milligram of prednisone, 4 milligram of prednisolone and 0.5 milligram dexamethasone. So what are the side effects of glucocorticoids? So side effect of glucocorticoids are symptoms and signs of Cushing syndrome. So whatever the symptoms and signs in the Cushing syndrome is seen is the side effect of glucocorticoid, like diabetes mellitus, hypertension, obesity, stria, wasting, then osteoporosis, delayed wound healing, menstrual problem, moon phase, peptic ulcer, acne. All these features are almost symptoms and signs of Cushing syndrome. So what are the complication of Addison disease? If you not treated the Addison disease, patient will have a cardiovascular collapse because of hypotension, and coma and death may occur. So coming to the important topic, that is acute adrenal insufficiency. Other name for this acute adrenal insufficiency is Addisonian crisis, Addison crisis or adrenal crisis. So by definition, adrenal crisis is a potentially life-threatening medical emergency condition which is caused by extreme low level of cortisol in the body. So what are the causes for this acute adrenal insufficiency or adrenal crisis? Sudden withdrawal of steroid is a most common cause of adrenal crisis. Patient is taking a longer duration of long period of steroid. Once if you stop the steroid, patient will go for acute adrenal insufficiency. Following stress, those who have a latent adrenal insufficiency, developed a intercurrent disease or trauma, surgery or infection or prolonged fasting will result in acute adrenal insufficiency. Following sudden destruction of the pituitary gland, that is pituitary necrosis, as in Sheehan syndrome or pituitary adenoma hemorrhage, or condition like hormone, that is thyroid hormone, or a drug that increases the steroid metabolism given to the patient with hypoadrenalism will result in acute adrenal insufficiency. Following bilateral adrenalectomy, following injury to the both the adrenal gland, trauma or adrenal vein thrombosis or adrenal hemorrhage due to meningococcal septicemia, that is called Waters Fredrickson syndrome, or following overdose of anticoagulation therapy will lead to the hemorrhage into the adrenal gland and result in acute adrenal insufficiency. So what are the clinical features of this acute adrenal insufficiency or adrenal crisis? So nausea, vomiting, abdomen pain, unexplained fever, almost mimic like a acute abdomen. Then diarrhea, muscle cramp. In some patient, primary presentation itself is a resemble a neurological disease, that is loss of consciousness, progress to stupor and coma. On examination, patient will have severe hypotension which is not respond to the either fluid or vasoconstrictor. Investigation, there is a hyponatremia, hyperkalemia, metabolic acidosis, hypoglycemia and hypercalcemia. So treatment of this acute adrenal insufficiency or adrenal crisis is you have to give a glucocorticoids and replace the sodium and water deficits. This can be achieved by IV infusion of normal saline or dextrose saline solution at the rate of 1 liter per hour with continuous cardiac monitor. Once the patient improves, you can reduce the rate of infusion. Bolus IV infusion of 100 milligram of hydrocortisone, which is followed by continuous infusion of hydrocortisone at the rate of 10 milligram per hour
you can give. Alternatively, you can give 50 milligram of hydrocortisone IV every 6th hourly. Once patient start improving, you have to reduce the steroid dose over 1 to 3 days. So maintain the blood pressure by IV saline or vasopressor, dopamine. Use broad spectrum antibiotic. Identify the precipitator factor and treat according to that. Once the dose of hydrocortisone reaches less than 50 mg per day, you start mineralocorticoid therapy, that is fludrocortisone 100 microgram, that is 0.1 mg per day. Why this mineralocorticoids are not started in during higher dose? Because higher dose of hydrocortisone provides a sufficient stimulation mineralocorticoid receptors. That's why no need of mineralocorticoid substitution in higher dose of hydrocortisone. So these are the questions you have to answer within the 3 days and mailed to the departmental email ID. Thanking you.